Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Beverly Morgan Welch. I'm the Executive Director of the Museum of African American History in Boston and Nantucket, and I want to welcome you to the African Meeting House. This is a wonderful event to have here for several reasons, not the least of which it is the cultural community coming together to help our leadership understand the importance of this sector and the work that we do within it and beyond.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. The significance of our creative impact, of our impact in preserving the past and moving forward into an incredible future, depends upon the work that we do. When I look at the space that we are in, I can only think of the meetings that occurred here that were firsts. It is where the New England Anti-Slavery Society was formed by William Lloyd Garrison and his anti-slavery friends. Because it is an African meeting house, you might imagine that they were black, and indeed they were. The first 12 who formed that society here created a space in which they determined that they would end slavery in the nation. I think if they could end slavery in the nation, we can certainly have Boston live up to its cultural history. Were places for all kinds of activities. A school existed here that began in 1798. This building was built in 1806 after an organizing black community determined that they needed their own place to gather, not only for that church work and educational work, but I don't know, to present Mozart. Said to be the best concert of the year in Boston, held here with an all-black group of musicians and voices to go along with it. It also was a place in which several musical groups, colleges, women's activist groups came here together to be able to work together for a shared goal. As we know, we have come together over many years with a shared goal, and that is to have leaders who share our interests and will look after our institutions, artists, the children who need those institutions so much. So we welcome MASSCreative here today. We welcome candidate Walsh here today and hope that you will return often. We love to partner. And now it is my pleasure to introduce to you the executive director of the celebrity series, Gary Dunning.
All right, I just want to take a few moments to talk a little bit about MASSCreative. I'm very proud of this celebrity series, being part of MASSCreative and Create the Vote. I think it's an incredibly exciting time to be in the art scene in Boston, and I think Create the Vote is just one of the reasons. Celebrity series is celebrating its 75th anniversary this year, and we kicked that off with the first project, Street Piano to Boston. This was an event that one of the goals was to frankly show to Boston, and frankly show to ourselves, what can be accomplished when people work together and when groups work together. It took over 75 individual visual artists and over 80 different cultural arts and community-based organizations to make street pianos a reality. Now, over the course of the festival, I was powerfully reminded of how much the arts matter to Bostonians, from all neighborhoods, from all backgrounds, of all ages. Over a 500,000 people stopped at one of our 75 pianos to play, to listen, and to share music with their fellow citizens. Now, one of the things in preparing for that festival, obviously there were a lot of meetings and a lot of permits that we went through. And the refrain I kept hearing, well, Gary, aren't you concerned about the panel? What about vandalism? What about damage? And in another sign of how much Bostonians value art, we documented three cases of vandalism. All three were people breaking blocks on the keyboard so they could spend more time playing the piano. I want to draw a clear connection between the MetLife Street Piano of Boston and this gathering here today. MASSCreative is a statewide advocacy organization that exists to generate support for the creative, cultural, and arts community across our Commonwealth. We do so because we believe, in fact, we know that cultural prowess is essential for a vibrant economy, an effective education system, and a healthy community. We also believe that collective action and genuine collaboration, like the kind we saw at street pianos, is essential for creating a stronger cultural sector. Now, Create the Vote was established to ensure that arts and culture, its people, its institutions, and its issues are not ignored in the coming elections. In this case, the election for the mayor of Boston. It's clearly a unique opportunity and a long-awaited one to engage candidates, to listen and learn and assess their position. Create the Vote sent around questionnaires to all the candidates and received thoughtful responses across a wide range of issues. We then met individually with each candidate, with over 20 of our colleagues from various institutions representing individuals and organizations across the city. So I think at this point that the candidates weren't certain that we were deeply interested in building a working collaborative relationship with the next mayor of Boston. Well, Create the Vote's Mayoral Candidate Arts Forum certainly made the point. We had over 700 people and packed the Paramount Theater, and we left 100 at the door trying to get in. I think it was a great opportunity to listen to all the candidates and hear their positions and hear their case for why they should be the next mayor. So now, we've progressed and we're down to the final two candidates. And congratulations to both of you. I'd like to turn the podium over to Joyce Bohaven, an Emmy Award-winning Arts and Entertainment critic, president of the Boston Theater Critics Association, and founder of Joyce's Choices.
Thank you so much, Gary. As all of you know, I eat, sleep, and breathe the arts, as you all do in this room. So, what a beautiful morning this is. We are all so thrilled that we have two candidates for mayor, Marty Walsh and John Connolly, who have already raised the bar on what we can expect from the city in terms of its commitment to arts, culture, and creativity and this community. To date, the work of the Create the Vote Coalition has earned unprecedented commitments from these candidates to do the following: appoint a cabinet-level position for the city of Boston dedicated to arts and culture, to integrate arts and cultural policy plans into city planning and city development, to invest in arts and cultural institutions, to develop a citywide strategic cultural policy, to lead by example by convening community leaders and attending events. And we are having this forum here so that we can dig a little deeper, so that we can talk specifics, and we can find out more from the candidates about how they plan to turn their ideas into concrete reality. And there can be a huge gap there. So we're going to try to find out what some of the bridge work is. We want to thank Marty Walsh so much for being here today. Our state representative and candidate for mayor of Boston, we know this must be the first of 20 events you've got today. So we're very grateful that you take the time. Is that right? Amazing. Thanks for taking the time. It takes incredible determination and tenacity to pursue elected office in this town. Thank you for being willing to serve the people of Boston. Just grill him. He's ready. He's ready to go. Never mind. Marty.
Thank you very much, and I'm sorry I'm using this just for a minute, because I do have a few notes here that I want to pass on. Not pass on, but just so I don't miss something. Oh, this is great. How is everybody doing today? This building is magnificent. I was here earlier in the campaign, and the history and everything of this building is just incredible. I'm fortunate enough and blessed to work up the street with the Golden Dome underneath it, and this whole area, the history of this area, it's just unbelievable. First of all, I want to thank MASSCreative, and the forum that you had is incredible. The amount of people, I actually snuck a few people in. They were walking up the stairs, and they said, well, I can't get in. And I said, well, you're with me. And they weren't even from Boston. And they walked in with me into the forum, and it was really incredible, the amount of people. So I want to thank you for that. I also want to thank MASSCreative. The first time that we had a meeting, and I've said it a couple of times, I went into the meeting and we talked about some of the issues of where I stand on our policy, or so I'll call it our policy for now. And, you know, I said it's a work in progress, we're learning. And as the campaign has gone on, really I've had the chance to, every discussion that I have in this campaign, when I talk about arts, heads nod. When I'm in a meeting talking about youth violence, we talk about bringing arts back and working with it to take care of violence, heads nod. When I'm talking to senior citizens at a coffee hour and talking about bringing arts back to the schools, heads nod. When I'm talking to the business community about creating and building Boston, I talk about having public art and more arts spaces, heads nod. Wherever I go on this campaign, when I talk about the arts, it's the only issue that you get a reaction out of somebody in the room when you bring up a different issue. It's the only issue, and which is incredible, and that says a lot to where we are. Under my administration, I want to make sure we have an arts renaissance in the city of Boston. And it's extremely important. Now, Joyce Kilhaywood, who I just love being, I watch her on TV forever, I love when you're doing this stuff, it's unbelievable. You know, I know what Joyce Kilhaywood does, and she mentioned today a few things about, in my campaign, we were the first candidate to talk about creating cabinet level position for the Arts Commission. Now, when I said that, it was the right thing to say, and I had a lot of people pushing me that way. When I say that today, it has a whole different meaning to me. Because yesterday, we unveiled a Boston Economic Development Plan for the future of our city. And when I started in this campaign to talk, I talked about arts and tourism. You know, we're going to strengthen the arts and tourism, And then, as we went into this campaign, I understood there's a huge difference. You know, I can't say that and pretend to say to you, you know, 5 months ago that I understood everything about the arts community. And I can't stand up here today and tell you the same thing. But I certainly do recognize there's a big difference. And what we did yesterday, as we're creating this new economic development office, we're putting tourism in there. Tourism belongs in there because it's an economic engine for the city of Boston. And we're going to partner the arts commissioner with this cabinet level of economic development so they can work together. And we can be able to tell a story through the arts through developments. We can tell a story to the arts through my police commissioner and crime. How do we deal with crime in the street? How do we deal with addiction in the street? How do we deal with making sure that our seniors have programs? How do we deal to make sure that our wonderful institutions in this city are able to thrive and move on? How are we going to be able to access our institutions that we have in the city to make sure that it's free for young people to get into those museums? You know, I understand that in Boston, in every city, major city in the world, for every dollar invested, we get six back. So when I was asked the question 3-4 months ago, when we sat down in the office and said, are you willing to invest in putting the arts in the line item in the budget? I said, well, we're going to look at it. And when you look at this now, and you're saying, we're getting $6 back for every dollar, the commitment is there for me. I am going to make sure that there is a line item in the city budget for the arts in the city of Boston. We also want to make sure that arts are accessible in all communities. And in the neighborhood, when I started this campaign, the very first place that I kicked my campaign off was the Strand Theater. And I believe it's open 3 or 4 days a week, maybe. We need to open that building more, and we need to take our institutions like that and open it up so we can really allow young people and elderly people and middle-aged people to express themselves. So my commitment is when I get elected mayor of the city of Boston, you know, I know we have the program in the Strand now, but I want to utilize the Strand and try and get that building open 18 hours a day. And not just the Strand, but other venues in our neighborhoods. I want to look at schools. I want to open school space at night to make sure that we can use the schools for our programs. In some of those schools, we do have theaters. But we have a plan in my campaign to build new schools in the city of Boston and use the meals tax and use the school building authority and the state to be able to create new schools in Boston. And as we create those new schools in Boston, design them so we can design theaters in those schools. So when we talk about having a true program in our schools for the kids and for the community, those programs are there. And those are things that we, as we're moving forward here in the Walsh administration, we're going to start to begin to focus and make sure that's part of that. I also think it's important when we talk about arts in schools, we talk about dancing, bringing dancing into our schools, because it's physical education. It's an opportunity for us to make sure that our kids can get physical education while they're also expressing themselves, while they're also learning things about their culture and arts and things like that. It's an important piece of that. The arts is an economic engine for Boston. They're one of the big three. Billion-dollar industry here in Boston. And one of the candidates who was running for mayor who is supporting me, John Barros, in his restaurant, he is live music in his restaurant. And when you look around the city of Boston, I believe there are maybe three venues today, maybe four, that have live music. We should look at that and bring that back to our neighborhoods. Again, another way for young artists that aspire to be able to express themselves. Housing co-ops, we have a plan on the housing. That is the Four Point Channel residents. I met with them. We went down and talked about years ago how we all knew this. There was a pretty decent amount of our space in our city as far as housing. We don't have that today. We have to be creative. We have to be creative in how we're going to be able to do this. So we have a plan about co-ops and housing co-ops and being able to turn some of our buildings in Boston that are empty now, that are sitting there, how can we turn into living space and workspace? And actually, we expanded that into startup and incubator space for venture capitalist companies. We talked about that. How do we create taking that idea that the arts community has and turn it into using it in the business community? And that's what we want to do, share the ideas. Mass cultural grants. The thing that I knew about the most as far as when I started this campaign, I know about the most because the Mass Cultural Society would come into my office all the time and say, you have to file an amendment to get more money. So I knew that. I knew how that works. But we need to make sure, not only how it works, but we've got to make sure that the city is stepping up to the plate to match the grants. And the more money that we can get in, we got to try and push Mass Cultural. That's a different issue for a different day. We have to fight it up in this hill up here. And we will. As the economy turns around, we will fight that. Let me just read you just a couple things that I don't mean to read off of those, but I just want to tell you a couple things that we're talking about in our office. We're going to create an Office of Cultural Affairs headed by a commissioner. The office is going to provide services for artists and art institutions in many forms. The office is going to work closely with the City of Boston Economic Development Authority, which will house tourism, creative economy, and Boston's film office. So that's what we talked about yesterday, creating. The new BRA will no longer be. We're going to change the structure of it. The arts community is going to be working with that office to be able to enhance the arts in our city of Boston. And when I say the arts, I'm talking in all forms. We will hire a chief development officer to seek support grants and sponsorship opportunities. We want to be able to create an opportunity in the city of Boston where right now they work in silos where people are going for grants. Each agency, the police goes for their own grants and different folks go for their own grants. We want to be able to put a centralized office in there so we can continue to go for grants and also provide assistance for nonprofits that need help with getting grants because some nonprofits don't have grant writers. And that's how you get your money. And that's where we're able to do that. The Convention Center Authority in Boston gives away small grants, $5,000 sometimes. Some programs take advantage of it. I know Medicine Wheel is taking advantage of it. Some other Georgia Salon programs take advantage of it. That's small money, but it's big money. $5,000 grant for some programs is huge money. So we want to be able to assist the different programs around the city of Boston. We also want to, and I mentioned this earlier, we want to make sure there are robust music programs in the city, in our schools. That's an important piece. I talk about Medicine Wheel all the time because of the kids. You know, that's my connection to Medicine Wheel. I know Michael as well. I don't think Michael's here, but it's the kids. I'm in recovery. Oftentimes, when these young people are in recovery and they go to Medicine Well and they're there doing different things, they made a book for me about their feelings, expressing themselves about when they first got sober. And we read the book, and they did it specifically for me because they knew I was in the program of Alcoholics Anonymous. And when they were doing it, they talked about the feelings they had when they entered the program. Desperation, sadness, thoughts that aren't normal thoughts. And as they went through the book was talking about recovery. And they talked about forgiveness and understanding and serenity. And then at the end of the book, it talked about happiness, being able to achieve whatever they want, sense of pride. That's telling a story. That's what I know about the arts community the most, is what I watch those young people go through, that was putting a needle in their arm, shooting heroin in their arm. And then after they get into the program, get into recovery, get into the program, that needle thought is not there anymore. And if it is there, they think about accomplishments they've made. You know, and when I started this campaign, that was my thought process as far as knowing the arts completely. Now I know that's not just it, but I'm willing to listen and learn and open up, and that's why we'll put, I think, such a great plan together. We're gonna support the Boston Youth Fund and arts and cultural organizations to offer teens summer employment. During this campaign, I got a chance to go to the Wang Theater and tour the Wang. I went downstairs and I saw the kids downstairs at the Wang Theater, kids from Georgia, from Roxbury, Hip Hop, and Japan. It was about 35, I think, 40 kids in the program. And you know what they were doing? They were expressing themselves and they were having a great time. That might have been the only time some of those kids have ever walked into the Wang Theater. I told the story of walking into the Wang Theater at the MASSCreative meeting, and I think people thought I was crazy because I went to the theater, it was great. I went to see Jersey Boys, and I went to see Lion King, different things. People thought, that's great, yeah, you're really a good actor. You know, I found that out afterwards. But I went downstairs and I saw the kids expressing themselves. Being able to dance. They can't dance in the street corner. I couldn't dance in the street corner. I grew up in New York, so we didn't dance in the street corner. We didn't sing. You know, we didn't express ourselves. We were hanging on the corner. And it's important for us to be able to allow those opportunities. I'll be done in a second, so I know you want to ask me questions. We want to create an artist first initiative to address artists' occupational health needs, professional development, affordable artist space, fair trade. In case you haven't heard, the newspaper every now and then references the fact that I might have been part of a union at one point. Okay, so I'm going way on the limb here. I want to ensure that the city abides by fair labor standards, that artists receive fair compensation for the work and services when engaging the city. Again, I know that's not how the papers are portraying me as a person fighting for benefits for working class people, but I just want to throw that out there. Couple more quick things. Elder affairs. We need to make sure we collaborate with elder affairs. We need to make sure that, particularly for folks in mid and late life careers in the arts, we need to be able to add that structure to that program. I know that elder affairs doesn't do it today. We need to continue that. The new office that we're going to create, we're going to partner with the cultural affairs to prioritize the growth of the Boston's film sector. One area in the city of Boston, I was part of the legislature that allowed to bring more films into Boston. And then I had the film industry coming into my office at the state house saying, this is great, but we can't get a permit to close the street down and blow a camera. So if we, it's to me, I'm like, okay, it's great. So, you know, if something wants to blow a camera in the middle of a movie, let's do it. You know, but we gotta be more open. Simply having it is fine, but we need to make sure we push back, because that's a way of selling our city. We're gonna conduct a needs assessment to protect Boston's historical cultural assets. And that's very important, because that doesn't happen enough in Boston.
Hallelujah.
We're gonna support dynamic public arts year-round programming in the parks. We're gonna take parks and recreation, we're gonna put recreation back in the parks.
Yeah.
Okay? That's where it belongs. And now the city has a program called Arts in the Park. And I believe there's a traveling truck that goes to different parks, and that's the arts. So they're in and out of the park for a night, and then they're somewhere else tomorrow. I want to be able to say, how can we make sure we have arts in every park in our city? Some will be better than others, but we need to make sure we promote that and push that, because that tells a story of our neighborhoods. I know I'm missing a couple of things. Give me one more second. I want to establish strong relationships with our sister cities. And I think that's extremely important. You know, at the forum, they asked me, give me a city in the country that, give me a city that you would look at to possibly steal some ideas. And Mike Ross was sitting to my right, and Mike actually said he felt bad for me. So he was about to lean into me and give me something. I swear to God. And I said, Montreal. And he looked at me and he says, where the hell did you come up with that? And I said, I'm doing my homework. And, you know, but the importance is that we have great people like Mike Ross in this race who truly understand and was a champion for a lot of people and I think had a lot of support in this room. But we're able to work on it, take each other's ideas and work and talk about how we move our city forward. I'm almost done. I just want to make sure I get it all. I just want to be asked. One thing that, I think my notes are done. One other thing that I just want to mention here for a minute is in this race, when it started, there's a lot of discussion about the different neighborhoods in the city of Boston and the different opportunities in the city of Boston. And certain neighborhoods get more opportunity than other neighborhoods. But we need to make sure when we talk about our policy and talk about future artists, that we include the entire city of Boston, not just some parts of Boston. We need to make sure that in the communities of color, that the opportunities are the same as everywhere else. And the reason why I say that is because as this campaign has gone on, you just really understand that the disparity between people, between neighborhoods. And yesterday I was at a Chamber of Commerce breakfast, and I was asked the question about what's the diversity of my office going to look like. We hear this every day. What's the diversity of your office going to look like? And, you know, of course, the answer is, and it's a true answer, is my cabinet is going to be made out of 50% people of color, because that's the city of Boston. And then we talk about what's my administration underneath going to look like, and then the city of Boston, we have 64 positions right now of management. Four people of color in those 64 positions. So we are going to make changes. I'm going to have a chief diversity officer in the city of Boston to force me, to push me, not force me, to make sure that we make those changes. But yesterday, I'm at the Chamber of Commerce, and somebody asked me a question. They talked about, they were really concerned about the diversity of the city. So they said, you know, what are you going to do to promote the diversity in the workforce in the city? And I said, well, not only am I going to change the diversity of the workforce in the city, I'm going to change the diversity of the workforce in the business community. And there was a lot of people in there. I've seen a lot of shoulders. And some people might have been there, and I don't want to, you know, I don't want to insult them, but, you know, truly, we have to make sure that this city is open for business for everybody from all aspects, whether it's the art or business or culture. I'm getting the hope. James is coming together.
Can you be more specific about the timeline you had in mind? Would that happen within the first 6 months, the first year? How do you see some of these specifics rolling out?
The way this is going to happen is I'm intending on getting elected mayor of Boston November 5th. November 6th, after the day after the primary, I was at the station at 5:30 in the morning because they wanted to film me for TV. And so that was the day after the election. This day, I'm going to get elected, hopefully November 5th. The next day, I will not be at the station at 5:30 in the morning. I'll be there later on, but I intend on, after I get elected, putting together my transition team. My transition team is going to begin the process of building my cabinet, and I intend on having my cabinet in place. Timeline within the first 30 days of taking over as the mayor's office, particularly the cabinet, having people in place so we can hit the ground running. Through the transition, we'll talk about how we're going to move into different areas and how we're going to merge different departments. But that'll be done from the 6th of November through the January 6th of election. And then we'll be working on hitting the ground running day one.
And that would include a cabinet position for arts and culture?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Questions? Ron?
Yeah. Could you be a little more specific about this commissioner? And let's say, what would be the top three tasks that the commissioner would be having to undertake short term, as soon as he or she gets involved? I mean, very as specific as you can get.
Well, the commission is going to be cabinet level, so we're going to have cabinet meetings every week. They're going to be sitting in the mayor's office with the other cabinet level visit people, meaning the police commissioner, fire commissioner, all the, whatever the cabinet looks like when we're there. So they're going to be sitting in on the meeting. Specifically, the first thing that person is going to be responsible for doing is beginning on working on the budget. The budget's going to be in April, so we're going to be able to have to create the new budget, and as we're putting this budget together, the 1% or whatever the number is going to be for the arts line item in the budget, they're going to begin working on that, number one. Number two, the person is going to also talk about looking on large scale and small scale as far as how they're going to, how we're going to, the city is going to set up a partnership with the community and how that community, how that partnership is going to work, meaning access to the mayor's office, creating some type of council where the arts community in Boston will have a meeting with the commissioner to build that relationship so that there's a direct line into the mayor's office. That's the second piece. I mean, that's as far as specifically who's going to be on it. It's going to be open up. One of the things that people are concerned about here is transparent process and not having a seat at the table. This is going to actually make a seat at the table. So there's discussions on putting the budget together and how we're going to implement some of the programming in the high schools, in the schools, and how we're going to carry that stuff out. And the third piece is the commissioner is going to be an ambassador to Boston. So that person, I'm expecting that person to tour around the country to work and take best practices and take some ideas on how we can best capitalize and work our arts community together. So that person is actually going to have real concrete. This isn't a figurehead. This is a capital level position. Just like my economic development officer is going to be responsible for going out and attracting new business into Boston, this person is going to be going out to work on art program, bringing arts, different arts programs to Boston, different cultures and everything that we want to do.
Ruth. Hi, I'm Ruth Bermer, Executive Director of Boston Men's Line, to do everything we can to keep Boston thriving and growing in Greater Boston. I represent a lot of independent artists and small companies, and there's been a concern amongst them about joining, as we talked about even this morning, of tourism with arts, and the current situation has meant arts has been secondary, and it's like you expand on how the arts will end up not getting lost and be best served for the small as well as the large.
Thank you. Yesterday, we unveiled a new plan for, we know the VRA, so we have the VRA in Boston. We're going to change that VRA. We're going to call it the Boston Economic Development Authority. We are going to take D&D and put it under this agency. We're going to take the VRA and EDIC, merge them together into one agency. They're going to all be under this director. So all of our development and planning in the city of Boston, any agency that does any type of construction is going to be kind of housed under this project. We're going to put arts, tourism is going to be under this. So any development, any type of economic engine for Boston is going to be put under this department as far as tourism goes and how we're going to attract tourism. Arts and culture is going separate. It's an own separate, independent agency. The only relationship between the two is the cabinet level positions. So the cabinet, we're going to have the same type of authority. The cabinet level folks are going to be sitting in rooms together, talking about how they can work off each other, how they can feed off each other. As we're doing developments in the city of Boston, we'll just use public art for a second. As we're doing developments, the economic development agency director with the staff on him will be talking about arts, how do we allow more space for public art? But they're going to be working with the arts commission, arts cabinet level position. So they're very different, they're separate, they're not together. And in order to do what we want to accomplish, what you have to do is, that won't happen as quickly as the cabinet level position is going to happen immediately. It won't happen as quickly because we have to go through a legislative process to change it. We're also going to put term limits on the boards of the economic development, 2 5-year term limits. That's it. And then we bring in new people. Well, I mean, 10 years from now, I don't think I'll be there, but some new people. So we have, it's a separate break. It's a clean break. It's a good break. It's the right break. He's a great man.
He is. But
he's in a tough situation for 3 more months. And he won't be in a tough situation. So, you know, I think one of it, one of it, we're not really creating a whole agency. We have the agency there, we're just elevating positions there. We are looking at, and the discussion has been preliminary before I actually take over the mayor, the figure that people have been asking, 1% of the budget. So we're going to look at that 1% of the budget. I can't tell you that today. I think the budget this year was $2.5 billion. So 1% of that, or it depending, I'm assuming revenues are going to go up, so it could be a little higher than that. So we're looking at actually really creating that. I know that the arts office today can't do anything because they have to depend upon grants and people paying for things, and I understand that today. It has to be different than that. That money that they'll get, that 1%, will allow the Arts Commission to actually build an office. And that's when we talk about partnerships and going back and reaching out to people. Today, you're like, well, how do you do that? Because you only have one person or two people. You're able to do that with staff folks. And you're able to bring people in and say, okay, let's really, truly have partnerships here. So we're going to look at that. Also, there's going to be ways of us to leverage other money in the city, whether it's through linkage or partnerships. I think when I mentioned this, I made a mistake. I think the day that the cultural one, I talked about, you know, let's tap into our museums here in Boston. There are plenty of philanthropists in the city of Boston that want to invest in the arts. And I think when people see that Boston is truly investing in the arts, you will see that money start to flow into the city of Boston. That's how I feel.
Okay. I think you had a question. We're all set. Okay, question. One more question. We've got one more. Sarah.
Hi. I'm Sarah from After Shakespeare Project. One of the things we'd love to see is how all the candidates started to feed on each other's ideas, and that sort of really exciting arts vision has started to come out. But now I'm wondering how you would differentiate yourself from John Connolly, because what you're both saying is very exciting and very similar.
I don't know what John's saying. When I'm out on the campaign trail, wherever I go, I talk about the arts. I don't always hear. So, I mean, he's out there talking, I guess, about it. I really don't know how we're different. I certainly know that when I talk about what I've talked about today, I haven't heard any other candidate talk about it on the campaign trail. Maybe when you're in a room with him, he's saying some similar things, but it's going to be about the commitment. I know on my campaign, John Barros supported my candidacy. John was very involved in making sure talking about the art community. I know that Phyllis Arroyo has joined my campaign. I know that Charles Richard has joined my campaign. And we talked about that. They joined the campaign because they believe in the mission, what we're talking about. I really can't comment on what John is doing. All I know is that I'm making my commitment. I'm a person who keeps his word, somebody who backs up what he does. And you talk about this record of accomplishment. My record of accomplishment in the arts community is fighting for mass cultural rights. That's what I've been asked to do over the years. As mayor of the city of Boston, understanding the importance of the arts community and the economic engine that's in front of us here. I'm talking about taking Boston into the 21st century. I know we're in the 21st century, but I'm talking about taking Boston into the 21st century. And there's a lot of ways of doing it. So, sorry, my words were so inspiring. See that? That's the difference right there.
We're going to take one more question.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, if that's okay. One more question. Okay.
This is not so much a question, but
no, it's got to be a question.
Those ideas and work with the community to be able to expand it. I mean, when I talk about vision, as mayor of the city of Boston, I'm going to appoint a police commissioner. I don't know how to be a police officer. So I'm going to allow that person to be the police commissioner and be the police commissioner. Superintendent of schools, I'm not a teacher. I'm going to make sure that that superintendent of schools is taking what my vision and what the vision of improving every school in the city of Boston and take that. I'm not a developer. So my economic development officer, capital officer, is going to take that. The same for the arts. I mean, the vision's big.